the Chair of the CNA Board of Directors, Frank Saunders.
I keep meaning to change that intro. It just really emphasizes how long I've been around in this industry. However, I want to talk to you a little bit about what the size of that challenge is. John talked about new nuclear and the challenge and the opportunity that comes with it. And we all talk about that a lot. I do notice when I talk to people, though, they haven't sort of really looked at the numbers and what they actually say. And so I thought it might be useful just to look at a couple of slides here that help with that. Sorry, excuse me. So this slide is actually a depiction of the global energy demand in electricity. So this is only 20% of the total global energy demand, but it is the electricity portion. And it says some interesting things. And this is normally the way you see it displayed. And so some things I want to talk about. You see nuclear is 10%, which is very significant. This is 25,000 terawatt hours, by the way, total in this little circle here. So it's a big circle. And it is growing twice the rate of all the other energy demands in the world. So nuclear, you see, is 10. Renewables, you see, at 25%. It's a little bit misleading. About 17% of that is actually hydroelectric power, and about 8% is wind and solar. And so one of the issues you've got to look at is the rate at which this is growing is a real challenge for us. And if you look at any one way that you're going to meet it, it's not so easy. In fact, you would be debate whether you could do it. So the rate of growth, if you look at the last 10 years up to 2017 where we have data, the rate of growth is 571 terawatt hours a year. So before we can begin to reduce carbon emissions, we first got to keep up with the rate of growth. So we got to provide clean energy at the rate of 571 terawatt hours a year just to stand still, to actually not make any progress on carbon at all. So what does 571 terawatt hours a year look like? Well, Germany actually has the largest number of solar installations in the world. Pretty big, actually, all told. But each year you would have to do 14 times that just to break even. And if you look at wind, China has a third of the world's wind power. And you would have to double that every year just to keep up with the clean demand. And if you look at it from a nuclear plant point of view, it's about 80 nuclear units a year to stay even. That's 80, not 8. So when people say we really need to use everything that's there to win this battle, they're right. It's doubtful whether we can do it, period. We really don't have time to squabble about who's doing what. We just need to use everything we can. And so a little bit of a comparison about the different techniques to try and solve the low carbon issue. So in Ontario, as you know, I happen to have my app on my BlackBerry here. Well, it's not a BlackBerry anymore. I'm not sure what it is now. It's a Pixel, I think. Hard to keep up with this technology. On my Pixel here, it says we're 60.5% nuclear at the moment in Ontario, 24.2% hydro, 11.5% gas, 2.5% wind. That's what's happening this morning on the Ontario grid. So, many people look to Ontario and say, you've made huge progress. We're up there with the very best in terms of low CO2 emissions. And that's what this chart shows you. So in Ontario, where we've chosen to actually use nuclear to build refurbished nuclear and use it as a major part of our grid, our CO2 emissions are way down there, as you can see. In California, where they like to shut down nuclear plants and try and build other things, I think you'd be about five times us on their CO2 density. And that density is just the amount of CO2 you release for every megawatt you produce, or kilowatt, however you want to look at it. And Germany, which says it leads the world in this, is actually about 10 times worse. And their emissions have at best stayed steady, but most people would tell you they're going up. So I think the lesson from this is deciding that you're going to use an idealistic approach and try to do everything with one or two technologies just doesn't work. If you look at Ontario, Sweden, France, that's where we're making some actual inroads in the CO2 emissions. So what does that mean in Canada? Great that we look at the world, but what does it mean in Canada? Well, currently in Canada, if you look at the federal government's targets and their plans to reduce CO2 emissions, they are about 75 million tons of CO2 short of meeting their target. And in fact, that number keeps getting a little bigger. But today, in 2018, it's 75 million tons. So we did a little bit of a look here about reducing CO2, just looking at fossil generation of electricity, nothing else. And strangely enough, when you add up the fossil generation of electricity across Canada, you come up with numbers that are kind of similar to that. And of course, being in the nuclear industry, we wanted to see what it would take to actually reduce that to next to zero and actually take that 75 million tons of CO2 off of the government's list. And this is what it would take. So 4,900 megawatts of new nuclear, about 30% increase in the current fleet size, would give the government the target they want in terms of coal reduction. It would increase employment, reduce impacts on the environment substantially, and generally not cause a lot of disruption in the grid, because these are essentially coal plants for the most part, which already have the grid connections and other things there. So you use nuclear units, you surprisingly have about the same staff between new nuclear units and the coal plants. The infrastructure is there, the cooling water is there, many of the buildings are already there. So there's some great opportunity here. And these are the kind of things we need to start thinking about. We need to start using the math instead of the emotions to figure out how to solve this problem. So that's my talk for today. I just thought I wanted to give you a little picture of the size of the challenge. And Canada's challenge is actually pretty minuscule compared to others. We had some interesting talks yesterday from the head of the International Energy Agency and the numbers in the world. And he's going to present that report out at the talks in Vancouver on the Clean Air Ministerial, which I think will be very interesting to all of us. And he is really into numbers too. And I think the conclusion is pretty much the same. If we want to do this, want to have any hope of doing it, we need to use everything. And we in nuclear can help by leading the way and actually providing the answers that people can use. So thank you, and enjoy the conference. I think you will.